Okay, we want to welcome everyone this morning. We want to also thank the little children here for their voice and their participation. Did everybody have a good sleep last night? Good, good. Well, we want to welcome everybody to the Third and Fourth Angels Ministries. And our topic this morning is the prophecy and history of the changes of the Spirit of Prophecy books. That's our topic. That's a concern that I've had for many, many years. This morning, we tend to expose the issues, give you biblical scripture, and also references from the original Spirit of Prophecy books. Can I hear an amen?
Hallelujah.
Why? It's because the laws of this country have been changed, and immorality has raised itself in, and it's in a situation where it's concerning many, many, many families. So what did the Spirit of Prophecy books have for people in the last days? And before we begin, we want to ask if we may kneel and consecrate this time so we can learn something, we can share it, and we can prepare a people. Can we bow in prayer? Our Heavenly Father, in the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach, we ask for your blessings and the outpouring of your Holy Spirit upon each soul that is present in this sanctuary. Bless us this morning with thy Spirit, and we implore thee for a spirit of discernment in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, and blessed be thy name. And Yahshua's people said, Amen. The Australian Years in 1891 to 1900 by Arthur White, Alan G. White, Volume 3, The Lonely Years, 1876 to 1891. Was written by Arthur White, her grandson, entitled The Lonely Years of Alan G. White, which are 6 volumes. So in Volume 3 and Volume 5, you have the original information where the writings came to write the Czar of Ages. Okay? Now, we know with facts that the Czar of Ages was not written by Alan G. White, but was actually the premise of Marion Davis to write The Czar of Ages. She had asked Alan G. White for permission to write these books, or book. This was just one. She received that information from a book entitled Our Lord Upon the Earth, which was written in 1832. And 32 years later, in the year 1898 is when the book was published and voted to be named The Czar of Ages, which are the writings of Samuel J. Andrews, who was a Sunday keeper. Okay? Now, his research was on the life teachings of Jesus Christ, was a chronology of the life and teachings of Jesus Christ, which Ellen White's committee, as well as herself, were researching and studying, trying to put these little puzzles together on the life teachings of Jesus Christ. And since Samuel J. Andrews had found these opportunities very enlightening, he did that. And his book is entitled Our Lord Upon the Earth. Therefore, the first 3 chapters of your Czar of Ages is also listed in the Czar of Ages, which we will prove. And we will prove other key points in regards to what has happened. Who were the individuals in the committee who were voted to change the Spirit of Prophecy writings? Okay. Now, I do want to improvise that it was not Jesuits and Catholics, which many people have murmured, have assumed, have thought, or listened to somebody else say it when they never read it, saying it was a Jesuit or Catholic. But I proved without evidence, or with evidence, that it was Seventh-day Adventist officials. And we will give you the names of 5 people, which were actually 6, but there were 5 that were elected in the committee. They were all Seventh-day Adventists. It wasn't Catholics and Jesuits. It's a little different today. And like others that are preaching out there on 3ABN and other locations, I like to have them preach and use the original books. We will also prove, without doubt, that the books have to be rewritten before we meet the objections of the people Why? It's because the books have been plagiarized. The books that I have here to my left, Spirit of Prophecy, Volumes 1 through, or Conflict of the Ages, 1 through 5, Testimonies to the Church, 1 through 9, are books of a new order. The new books were put in there for a specific purpose that we will elaborate later. The original books are to my right. You have on the right-hand side of the stand, Testimonies for the Church, 1 through 30, and then Spirit of Prophecy, 1 through 4, the white ones, and then Redemption Series, which was next to it, 1 through 8. But just a little bit that I wanted to share with you, but this has taken some 20 years to do. Not only myself, but also those that have gone before me. Some of them have died. But the Alan G. White, Andrews University, all the libraries have this information. But they do not carry the original books. That's the problem. They made sure they would get rid of them. Samuel J. Andrews was a man of sound searching for the truth of Jesus Christ. But he was not inspired. The only one we know that was inspired was Alan G. White. Now I have lots to say, so I want to be very careful with what I will be saying. So as you view this DVD, you view this information, I implore you that you study the books. You will never get your answers with the new books of a new order. I've already gone through it, me and many millions of other people. You will get your answers in the old books, which are the original books. So we know that these old paths have been changed. 3.9 million people left the church, or 2.9 million people left the church, and yet we are still stagnated, still going to the Seventh-day Adventist churches, not resolving the issues of your Sabbath school quarterlies. Good studies, got airs in them, but everybody wants to live with air, and nobody's going to go to heaven with air. Okay, so we live a day of it, woman, today, and we see homosexuals and lesbians coming in, speaking in the Adventist church, in the schools of the Seventh-day Adventists. And we got Jesuits and Catholics speaking at Washington College there, which was Columbian Union College, Pacific Union College, Walla Walla College. So what do we do? Well, he's actually told us, come out. Come out of Babylon. Come out of the nominal Adventist churches. Come out of the Christian churches. But yet we're so hard-hearted. We're so used to going to the church building with a 501c3, listening to a sermon, a smooth sermon, but they're neither preparing you nor preparing nor letting you have the reign to go and evangelize in your communities in the country that you live in. And we will live with this until Christ comes back. Our topic this morning in part one, the prophecy in history of the changes of the Spirit of Prophecy books. In a conversation that took place many, many, many years, this is in chapter 32, 1892 to 1898, writing on the life of Christ, the Desire of Ages. A little bit about Marion Davis was the elite secretary of Alan G. White. She had gone to the schools to learn, and by learning the Gospels and events of the life and teachings of Jesus Christ, she shared that with Alan G. White. Alan G. White had told Mary to find her some histories of the Bible would give me the order of events. Letter 38, 1885. The gospel writers in their accounts did not help much in the point of sequence in the advance of direct instruction from Alan G. White, or clues in the materials themselves. Mrs. Davis, Marion Davis, consulted carefully prepared harmonies of the Gospels, and as the work progressed, made considerable use of Samuel J. Andrews on the book entitled Life of Our Lord Upon the Earth. I was close to the correction there, or that's the correct name. Life of Our Lord Upon the Earth. This book, ladies and gentlemen, was actually printed in 1832. We have that original book. It's on the shelf there on top. It's a book that I hardly touch because it's very fragile. It's very old. And so if you like to view it, I can show it to you, okay? Which was noted on the title page, took into account historical, chronological, and geographical relations. If ye are a Seventh-day Adventist and have left the Seventh-day Adventist Church, or are in a self-supported ministry, ye are still responsible for the messages. We are still held responsible. Ain't that interesting? So you left the church, and you think everything's going to be fine and dandy, but yet you're still carrying Books of a New Order, Conflict of the Ages, Patriarchs and Prophets, Prophets and Kings, Desire of Ages, Acts of the Apostles, and the 1911 Great Controversy, corrupt books. But you wouldn't know it because you didn't have the privilege to research out the history of it. Well, now in 2016, you have that privilege. Now you can know what is right and what is wrong. We are all held accountable, whether you are a pastor or a layman. It don't matter. What matters is the character of Christ being established in you, in me. I am no better than you. I'm the worser of sinners, and shamefully so. But today you have a privilege to learn the truth. We keep going to the churches, going to the churches. Everything's still the same it was since 1992. Nothing's changed. The only thing I guarantee you that has changed is that immorality has come in. And in 2006, they stopped publishing Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 1, 2, 3, and 4. You won't have them anymore. Number two, they stopped publishing Spiritual Gifts, Volume 1 and 2, which is one volume, Volume 3 and 4, which is the second volume. They don't publish it anymore. Those are correct books. They have not been infiltrated by our own denomination. Now remember, Catholics and Jesuits, you need to know their history, the scholars. You need to know that they had nothing to do with this. It was only Seventh-day Adventist officials, okay? Because Ellen G. White was already declaring what was going to happen present or past, present, and future to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And why the remnant is in charge now until the Second Coming. There is a responsibility. Now, as the work was thought to be nearing completion, which is the Desire of Ages, in 1896, thank you, Marion, working on the three general introductory chapters of Desire of Ages entitled God with Us, The Chosen People, the third chapter, and The Fullness of the Time. Those are Samuel J. Andrews' research and writings. They're not inspired. Although they look good, they look concrete, they look biblical, but they're not inspired. That's the difference. Richard wants everything that's been inspired, and she wrote it. You see, a prophet is not always envisioned 24/7. So for 1 hour, she can have a vision. She's being inspired. She's under the Holy Spirit. She's dictating what the Holy Spirit is telling her to do. And then after that is done, she's no longer under that authority, under that vision. This is why you have to understand what a messenger is called to do, what a prophet is called to do. They're sinners just like you and I. However, they've been instructed to do the things that Yeshua's called them to do. Okay? Let me go on. So we finished with The Fullness of the Time. Sought the counsel of Herbert Lacey of the Avondale School on the arrangement of paragraphs. He was a rather youthful graduate of the classical course offered at Battle Creek College. He made some helpful suggestions in the matter of the sequence of the thoughts presented, which when it became known gave birth in later years, when he was known as a seasoned college Bible teacher, to rumors that Lacey had a prominent role in unauthoring the book in both oral and written statements. He flatly denied such a role. D.F., page 508, H.C. Lacey to S. Kaplan, July 24, 1936, page 385. The next few months entailed the checking of proofs of the texts, and by this, many hours were spent. Of the two volumes, as the type was being set, Ellen White, as well as Marion Davis, her elite secretary, I will use that name continuously to elaborate that this was the lady behind the whole picture here. She was in charge. She's the one that went to the schools. And Willie C. White, her son, the other culprit that forged his mother's name and was involved in the book changes, we'll talk about that later, gave very careful attention to this close scrutiny was also given to the artwork, including many new designs. Let it now be supposed that Ellen White did not concern herself with details. She was paying for the printing, and she wanted them right on December 20th. She wrote to C.H. Jones. Now, these comments that I'm referring to come from this book, The Australian Years. This is the book that has been condensed with all the information of The Lonely Years of Ellen G. White, Volume 3 and Volume 5, to a point. All of it's in here. It's a small one, but it's all in here. All the facts of where Desarve Ages came from. Now, many of the professors in my time and teachers, when I was in the schools, because I went to five different of them, never had the opportunity nor the pleasure to research all this information to see if it was correct. They themselves accepted it as it was given to them from their professors, from their professors, from their professors, yet the problem was still in the church, which has never been resolved. Now it will be resolved. Now you will have the opportunity to make your choice either on the side of the remnant or on the side of Laodicea. So if you're a Seventh-day Adventist and you say to each other, well, we're in Laodicea. Well, we can't do anything about it. We're in Laodicea. Oh, yes, you can. You need to come out. You need to come out of Laodicea and you need to join that remnant. If you're a Seventh-day Adventist, you keep the Sabbath. You're a feast keeper, you keep the Sabbath. If you keep the Torah, if you're a Jewish person, if you belong to Christian nominal churches, you need to come out and join that remnant because that's the final picture. You and I have no choice. We've had long years in the churches. Now I'm speaking to Sunday keepers, Sabbath keepers, commandment keepers, atheists. This message is for every one of you. It's not for only a peculiar type of people. It's for people like me who was a sinner, who has been found wanting, and has cried out and repented and been baptized. The message is in the books. And it ends in the books. The books are to be revived, not you. You're only going to get revived as you read the books. Now you got a clear mind. Now you're coming into the sanctuary, being refreshed into the most holy of holies because the holy place is closed. It's got a lock on it. It's been locked. So when we baptize you into the most holy of holies where Christ is at. And he's not walking back and forth from room to room. That's a no-no. And we can show you from the 1884 Great Controversy on that issue. But let me continue going here. I wish to say to you that I am sadly disappointed in the cuts prepared for such a book as The Life of Christ. I consider that if Brother Razor accepts such figures, his eye and taste has lost its cunning. You cannot expect me to be pleased with such production. Look at these figures critically, and you must see that they are made from either Catholic designs, or Catholic artists, the picture of Mary has a man's face, the representations of Christ with the two fingers prominent, while the others are closed, is wholly a Catholic sign. And I object to this. I see but very little beauty in any of the faces or persons. Letter 81A, 1897, page 391 and 392. Now, if I had more time, which will be in another study, I can show you the Desire of Ages with all the Catholic pictures in it, all the Catholic designs, etc. We're not Catholics. That's why Protestant America's fallen, and someone else is on top, which is the Catholic denomination's theological views, which has crept into the church, and churches, plural, and we ourselves are left in what? In darkness, but not so. We need to come out because we can come out. I think that many people have been hurt. Many people have left the church for these reasons. But let me continue. The book Life of Our Lord Upon the Earth, written by Samuel J. Andrews, in which was a Sunday keeper, wrote Life of Our Lord Upon the Earth. It was printed in 1832. And 32 years later, in 1898, Desire of Ages was printed after it was voted on the name, in which Marion Davis used Samuel J. Andrews' writings to complete the book. It has taken many years to find this book, and today, in 2016, we have it. We can say that we carry this book, and very fragile book, of course. Note, The Life of Our Lord Upon the Earth by Samuel J. Andrews was written in 1866. Thank you, my mistake. 1866 A.D. And 32 years later, in 1898 A.D. My mistake. Pretty good for not having notes, huh? The committee and Marion Davis, after much research in finding other reference, says of the life and teachings of Jesus Christ, added the chapters from the life of our Lord upon the earth into the Desire of Ages. And the remainder comes from the Review and Herald Articles, Volumes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Now, let me have your attention for a minute. And I want to discuss it in this manner. Desire of Ages, when you read the first, second, third chapters, comes from Samuel J. Andrews. You will find parts through that book to the end that are a synopsis of the writings of Samuel J. Andrews. Now, in Volume 4 of Review and Herald book, Volume 4, Review and Herald, you will find chapters in there, the original chapters that they took out and inserted into the Desire of Ages to complete the book, which are Ellen G. White's writings. Now, when I share with you that Desire of Ages is not her book, I mean that. She didn't write the book verbatim. It was the writers that wrote the book. And Marion Davis copied Samuel J. Andrews' writings, Our Lord Upon the Earth, took those manuscripts out, and put them inside the book, and the committee voted on the name after numerous names were presented. Then the book was voted on the title and completed. That's where all that comes from. Now, I can pull you out Desire of Ages, which is this one here. Okay? She didn't write this book. That's my argument. She didn't write it. You and I are responsible for what we read. And ignorance, not knowing, is not an excuse. It's a sin. Okay? So when we review the books, Conflict of the Ages, she didn't write any of it. These are books of a new order. When she wrote the books, it was only 4 volumes. But they were not named Patriarchs and Prophets, Prophets and Kings, Desire of Ages, Acts of the Apostles. Volume 1, 2, 3, and 4 was the correct name, Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 1, 2, 3, and 4. The 1911 Great Controversy, corrupt to the core, it's no good. They added information in there and they took it out. Matter of fact, for you teachers, professors, and strong men in self-supporting ministries, that you think you're all tough and you want to disregard everybody else because they're studying, I got news for you. Listen to this. If you get the 1884 or 1858 and read them, you will see the difference. Specifically on the Sunday law. They added to the Sunday law, which she was not inspired to write. She wrote about a Sunday law. She was inspired, but not to the extent that this book is saying. Will it occur? Yes, it will occur. Okay? So I only wanted to bring these out to share with you. These are books of a new order. In continuing, we left off that Samuel J. Andrews had written his book, Our Lord Upon the Earth, in the year 1866. 32 years later, the committee votes on the name, Desire of Ages, and the book is completed and printed in the year 1898. So, what we find here is discrepancy, and we also find that it was also prophesied by Ellen G. White that books of a new order would come in and sweep away the structure. That's already happened. It was occurring when she was alive, ladies and gentlemen. It's not after. Okay, it was occurring when she was alive. Now we've come in the 20th century, 21st century, and we find and see all kinds of problems. Well, I thought this was the remnant church. Why do we have 3 million people leaving within a what? 2.5 year period? Is there any wonder what's going on? Is there any wonder there needs to be some reconciliation somewhere? The church was being judged already. In review, June 10, 1852, the church was already judged. 8 years later brings us to the year 1844. Well, I should say 1844 to 1852 brings us to when the church goes into Laodicean state. Never comes out. You find that in early writings. But they rewrote the book and took the information out, which we'll share with you later. Interesting to note that where is Christ in all this? Where's Christ in all this? In continuing, the committee and Marion Davis, after much research and finding other references of the life and teachings of Jesus Christ, added the chapters from the life of our Lord upon the earth into the Desire of Ages. Beautiful book, but it's not inspired. Okay? I can go on all day long, all week long with that book. And when we get done with that book, you're not going to read it anymore. Okay? The majority of the writings of that book come from the Review and Herald articles. That's where it comes from. And the reason why you're not ever allowed to read these books is because your pastors, your leaders, your laymen who want to be honest and devout have not been informed of this information. Matter of fact, they don't teach you in seminary school this issue. They teach you ecumenical issues. They teach you new theology, which you will do if you want to be employed within either denomination, rather Sabbath or Sunday keepers. You're going to teach their theology. You're not teaching theology that comes from the scriptures, that comes from the holy place, or the most holy of holies, or the art of court. You're teaching new theology. So when you find out what's happened, now you got to restudy all over again. And in a way, it's good on my part, because now I can explain it. And I guess we'll live with that until Christ comes. Therefore, the remainder comes from the Review and Herald Articles, Volumes 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. There are six books. Six books. Okay? This information is a completion of two books entitled Life of Our Lord Upon the Earth and Review and Herald Articles, Volumes 1 through 6. The Desire of Ages was printed by Marion Davis from its pages, Life of Our Lord Upon the Earth, and written by Samuel J. Andrews. I know I'm repeating here. And when a person is repeating, pay attention because it's very important. Okay, so it stays in our minds. Now this book, Desire of Ages, is by no means a doctrine book. It is nicely written, but by no means is it correct. By any means. There are errors, and of course this would take several months to give the classes with reading and studying the material. This book, if used by feast keepers and Sabbath keepers alone, will not defend your premise. So all these feast keepers who are really, really studying, and I admire what they're doing. Matter of fact, I've admired what they've done before I even came into the church and within the church, even at Pacific Union College, when all these pastors would come there to the college and listen to all the feast keepers, all the speakers that were speaking. I wonder, why come they're not preaching this in seminary school in our classes? Well, I know now why. Okay, I know now why. And it's very sad. Therefore, G.I. Butler, who was the president of the General Conference, was elected. He was the chairman of the committee of five. Also, S.N. Haskell, whose picture is right here behind us. Okay. Uriah Smith, who's right up there above you, Sister Elizabeth. J.H. Wagner, Sr., and Willie C. White, her son. Now, these five men in here were the individuals that were voted in the committee, who were Seventh-day Adventists, to change the writings of Alan G. White. I'll give you your references, and I hope you're writing these things down, because if you don't write them down, you wasted the time. Because you are a witness, my friends. You need to give this message to other people. After you've researched it left and right, and searched every corner to make sure that it's clean. Now, this has taken much time. It's not an easy task. Much, much time. Okay? So, G.I. Butler was the chairman, was also the president of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, of the committee. S.N. Haskell, Uriah Smith, who was the main culprit of changing testimonies to the church, Conflict of the Ages, specifically the Great Controversy. That's why he wrote his book, Daniel and Revelation, to supersede Ellen White's writings. They didn't accept her because all the message that she was receiving from Jesus Christ was actually giving damnation towards the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And we will prove that to you in a while for those that continue with us. Now, the Committee of Five were men of beautiful backgrounds, but I do want to share something about one individual, which I won't spend very much time with, because all our sins are going to be exposed before Christ comes. J.H. Wagner was an adulterer. He was married to his wife, but he went out on her, and he continued that relationship until he died. There's no signs that he repented of it, and he was told by Ellen G. White that you should not be in the committee. You have nothing to say. You are a man that's doing ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. Okay? And he was exposed by the churches, left and right, with many, many people. He has a history from Hidra, Alaska, and it's very bad. I have a history here, maybe all around the world, but I repented. I'm not doing what I used to do. Okay? Now, Ellen G. White prophesied of the confiscation of the books, her original books. Those are her original books. She prophesied about it. You find it in Testimonies number 13. Testimonies number 13, pages 11 to 13. Okay? They were not Catholics or Jesuits, but Seventh-day Adventist officials in the committee, ladies and gentlemen. Okay? This is who the culprit is. Okay? I'm going to give us an outline of the correct original names of the Spirit of Prophecy, volumes 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay? Now, the first book, Spirit of Prophecy, volume 1, is the Spirit of Prophecy, the great controversy between Christ and his angels and Satan and his angels. Okay? That was written in 1870. Okay? The second book is the Spirit of Prophecy, the great controversy between Christ and Satan, life, teachings, and miracles of our Lord Jesus Christ, printed in 1877, 7 years later. The third book is entitled The Spirit of Prophecy, the great controversy between Christ and Satan, the death and resurrection and ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ, printed in 1878, 1 year later. The fourth volume, The Spirit of Prophecy, the great controversy between Christ and Satan from the destruction of Jerusalem to the end of the controversy, was printed in 1884. That's the 1884 Great Controversy. However, that 1884 Great Controversy has 13 minute errors. I mean minute, but they're errors. Okay? But it's the best book we got, better than any of the other books. And the next book is the 1858. That's a correct book. It has no errors. So, the 1858 has the loud cry. The 1884 has the loud cry. It also has God honors the true, God honors the humble. Those chapters you will not find in the 1888 or 1911 Great Controversy. They're very important. Now, if you are studying to be among the 144,000, you need to know the loud cry. You need to know that. Okay? In the 1884, God Honors the Humble, page 197 and following, there are two witnesses in there. It says that the first angel's message was not given to doctors of divinity. That means that if you've gone to the seminary schools and you become a pastor or an evangelist, the first angel's message was not given to you to give. It was given to the meek, humble people. This is why you're not hearing it in your churches. But to go back before 1844, the first angel's message, the second angel's message, and in 1844, the third angel's message was given. Okay? As it was given, it terminated and ended in 1844. It did its job. It brought the people out of Babylon. Okay? And formed an Adventist church. And so when we come down to where it says in the reference review, June 10, 1852, 8 years later from 1844, the Adventist church goes into the Laodicean state. Never comes out. Are you hearing me? So what's the problem here? What happened here? Why were they found wanting? Because of apostasy. The same thing they're doing there in her time, they're doing today. Okay? That's another study. But let me continue going on here. Now, the Spirit of Prophecy speaks only truth, ladies and gentlemen. The Spirit of Prophecy speaks only truth. Now, let me give you an outline of books of a new order. These are books of a new order that I shared with you earlier, okay? Patriots and Prophets, it was printed in 1958, a year before I was born, 1959. Prophets and Kings, printed in 1917. Ellen White died in 1915. Give me a break. Oh, now, there's a year when she stopped all her writing. There's a year when she stopped all her writing. Okay? Listen to me. Let me repeat. Patriots and Prophets, printed in 1958. Prophets and Kings, printed in 1917. The Czar of Ages, printed in 1898. That's the correct date, 1898. Acts of the Apostles, printed in 1911. The Great Controversy, 1911, 1907, 1888 are one of the same book. Are you listening to me? They're the same book. Corrupt to the core, all these books. Now, a little bit on the Acts of the Apostles. Sketches of the Life of Paul. This is the original book. And what they did, they turned around and rewrote the book and gave us Acts of the Apostles. Well, when you finish reading this, you're not going to read Acts of the Apostles anymore. I can give you all the quotations and pages in Acts of the Apostles. And after you finish reading them and you've read this, you're going to stick here. You're going to see what really happened. This is what they did. Okay? Now, let me go on with a little bit more before we get into the meat. There are the books that have been rewritten by the Ellen G. White Estate, the Committee of Five Men, which I mentioned earlier, and by the direction of the Seventh-day Adventist General Conference Committee. Ellen G. White did not write these books. The above books are books of a new order. Reference, Testimonies to the Church, number 13, the original book, pages 10 to 12. The books are all corrupted by the changes that have been inserted in Changing the Truth of the Spirit of Prophecy books. For those that have come into the faith in the last few years are very welcome to study and ask questions, as well as those in the faith for the last 80 years. Now, what we have here is that books of a new order already came in. It was already prophesied that they would come in. And when the books were being changed, when she was alive, you better believe it, there was a big cry, there was a big yell. In 1883, in the General Conference session, she had word for word with the administrators, with the leaders, and she shared with them that the Lord had not instructed her to rewrite her books. And she says, why are you rewriting my books? That was the issue of 1883 General Conference session. Okay? The changing of the spirit of prophecy writings. Now, Ellen G. White, Messenger to the Remnant by A.L. White, page 65. Vital principles enunciated. And the question has come to this point that I will give you a reference and view of the minutes that took place in this committee. The question was of such vital importance that it was carried to the General Conference session of 1883. At that meeting, important decisions were reached which not only affected the reprinting of these testimonies. Remember, there are 30 testimonies. We got 30 testimonies. 1 through 30. Those are the testimonies, the original books, and you notice they're not an inch to an inch thick. Okay, those are the original testimonies. So you wouldn't find them at the General Conference GC session of 2015 out in Texas, because they didn't have them. And like I told the officials there, and I won't mention their names, I says, out of all the Spirit of Prophecy books, you don't have any of the original books. I says, all you have here is nothing but books of a new order. They got mad. And I began to elaborate for almost an hour. Question after question, answer after answer. I got a question, I got an answer. And so we went through it. You know, it's very sad that we don't do our homework and we think we do. And if you're going to teach me anatomy and physiology, well, I'm going to have to answer a lot of questions. And I'm going to have to ask a lot of questions. Because I want to be a good physician. I want to be a good massage therapist. But at the same time, they didn't have the original books. I've had these books since 1994. And it was the Holy Spirit that was able to teach, to be able to put it together. So if you have your books, books of a new order, I advise you, do not throw them away. And you can quote me, do not throw them away. You need them. You need to do your comparisons, Spanish or English. And everything came out in English, ladies and gentlemen. It didn't come out in Korean. It didn't come out in Russian. It didn't come out in Spanish. It all came out in English. So if you don't have it in English or you don't have it in Russian, then we're going to have to get somebody to put it in Russian. But that's not my fault. Okay? Bear with me. I don't speak Russian. Now, let me continue. At that meeting, important decisions were reached. And I will show you the important key points that they reached. But which also placed the denomination on record as to its understanding of certain fundamental principles having to do with the utterances of the spirit of prophecy. We quote from the minutes of the meeting in 1883. 32, whereas some of the bound volumes of the testimonies to the church are out of print so that full sets cannot be obtained at the office. And whereas there is a constant and urgent call for the reprinting of these volumes, therefore resolved that we recommend their republication in such a form as to make four volumes of 700 or 800 pages each. 33. Whereas many of these testimonies were written under the most unfavorable circumstances, listen to this, the writer being, referring to Ellen White, being too heavily pressed with anxiety and labor to devote critical thought to the grammatical perfection of the writings, and they were printed in such haste as to allow these imperfections to pass uncorrected. And whereas we believe the light given by God to his servants by the enlightenment of the mind, thus imparting the thoughts and not except in rare cases the very words in which the idea should be expressed, italics ours, therefore resolved that in the republication of these volumes such verbal changes be made as to remove the above named imperfections as far as possible without in any measure changing the thought. And further, number 34, resolved that this body appoint a committee of 5 to take charge of the republication of these volumes, according to the above preambles and resolutions. This was done in the Review and Herald of the date November 27, 1883. And 42 days later, they began to change the Spirit of Prophecy books. This is what took place. Now, the Adventist Church, ever since I've come in, and even before when I came in, they were making the excuse that Ellen White could not spell and read. She had grammatical problems. That's false. She could spell and she could read. This she could do. Her husband was a teacher, so he always edited the books. There wasn't a problem. The problem was in the officials of the Seventh-day Adventist Church didn't like what Yeshua was given to her for her to dictate and write. Under inspiration. So, 42 days later, they changed the Spirit of Prophecy books. Ellen G. White said, I expect to be betrayed. What? I expect to be betrayed. This is a prophecy, Review and Herald, Volume 1, page 372, October 16, 1883. Now listen to me. She said this in November 27, 1883. 42 days later, it happened. So, she said it October 16, 1883. 42 days later, November 27, 1883 is when it happened. Prophecy was fulfilled. You can see it in the screen. So, she says, I expect to be betrayed, as was my father. As was my Lord, excuse me. Remember, according to Haskell, Mrs. White predicted there would be a time when the testimonies would be in demand, just as they were originally given in order to meet objections before we got through. Look at this. In demand. 2 years later, Haskell wrote that such a demand was called for almost everywhere I go, he said. The demand was based upon the attacks changing that the writings had been altered to suit circumstances. Haskell to Willie C. White, November 4th, 1918. So you have approximately 3 years after her death. Okay? And you find the reference for this in the 1919 Bible Conference, page 24 and 25. Therefore, G.I. Butler, S.N. Haskell, Uriah Smith, J.H. Wagner, Willie C. White were the five men that were appointed and voted into the committee to change the Spirit of Prophecy books, volume 1, 2, 3, and 4, into five, Conflict of the Ages, and to change 30 testimonies to the church into nine volumes. This is what happened. Okay? Now, my concern for salvation is the correct message, to correct my sinfulness, and to have this mind transformed into the character of Christ. Can I hear an amen? Not reading books of a new order. It's all prophesied here by Ellen G. White. They didn't believe in her. Even W.W. Prescott, the vice president of the General Conference, also made changes of the Great Controversy. Okay, he's the sixth person. Now, these are people in position. Now, for references and for proof and for a foundation, Review and Herald Volume 5, the fifth volume, page 110, says, I said, if any of the citizens of Battle Creek wish to know what Mrs. White believes and teaches, or if any of the people in the world that live today in 2016 wishes to understand what Ellen G. White says, she says, let them read her published books. Her what? Her published books. She's pointing to her books. She's not pointing to books of a new order. She already knew that. And if you think for one moment that the people back then didn't know all this was going on, they knew. Just like today, you got the Great Hope. Is there a rejection on that? You better believe it. Because in the North American Division, everywhere I've gone, West Coast, East Coast, all I see is books entitled, what's the title? The Great Hope. Of boxes inside the pastor's office or in the corridor. This is what I see. The members in the church don't want to pass those out. So is there opposition? Yes. So then why are you still staying in the church? As long as you're in the church, you're never going to give the message. Why? Because you're in prison. You're in prison. You're under control. They're controlling your reins. From you saying anything, you turn to the right hand? No. Turn to the left hand? No. You're going to do what I do. Nothing. So we are responsible. Now, I know I'm saying it in a very harsh way, which I believe I shouldn't have a problem here because we're all being very harsh with each other in the Seventh-day Adventist Church anyway. Let me give you an example. All I wanted to know was the truth. And I got to realizing that many doctrines were not being studied by all these self-supported ministries that claim to be their it. Heartland College, UG Pines, international schools, different titles of schools, Pacific College, you name it, all these people, or colleges or schools within the denomination, as well as me, we're all sick. We're all sick. We've hurt each other. Just because one person believes something, I'm not going to be a friend of them no more because that's hearsay. Or that's an abomination. No, Ellen White says it. It's always Ellen White. Wait a minute. How do you know she said it, and how do you know it wasn't Christ that said it? You go to other churches, they show agape. And look at this, they're Sunday keepers. And it's prophesied that they are going to come in, which they're doing, and they're going to sweep away those that have not done not one thing out of 40 years as them being in the church. Christ didn't call you as a deacon to ordain you to sweep the rugs. He didn't call you and ordain you as an elder to wash the floors, to be a food server inside the fellowship halls, or as you would say it, self-supporting ministries and the church. How's the word? Not fellowship lunch, but what? Pot luck. That's mysticism. That verb shouldn't even be used within the denomination. And you want to be a remnant? A remnant doesn't speak that way, nor act that way, nor live that way, nor agape that way. It doesn't exist. That's why home church is returning back to home church. Because it began with the homes and it's going to end with the homes. So under your 501c3, your equipment doesn't belong to you. It belongs to the government. Go do your homework. I've had 3.5 years of criminology before my major was changed, as I heard his voice, to be a minister. So I know law. Does law help me? You better believe it helps me to argue the legal points legally, theologically, to argue the theological points theologically. That's why there's so much compromise. It's because we got to have the money coming in. We got to build up the bank. When yet, are we helping our members within the denomination with their mortgage, with food, with clothing, who are really in need, who lost their jobs? Is that really going on? Oh, but we have our footage and so forth that we give out every Wednesday night. Yeah, well, we believe the health message is 1863, and all we're giving to the people is unhealthy food. Why can't we give them food that, like grains and beans and rice, brown rice, wheat, whole wheat bread and so forth? Why can't it come out of the treasury, out of the church, instead of going to the food bank that the government supports and gives? Who's fooling who here? A remnant would have all the characteristics of Christ. Now, I'm not bashing all of us. I'm at fault myself. But it's about time that you as leaders come out and start standing up for truth. Eternal Gospel Ministries, all these ministries coming out with all kinds of stuff, nitpicking all over the place, and yet disfellowshipping each other because of, oh, I believe this way, and since you don't believe this way, you can't be a part of us. Well, who in the world said that you're the remnant? Because the only remnant I know is Jesus Christ, Yeshua HaMashiach. He's the remnant, and I got to be attached to him. Can I hear an amen? That's who we got to be attached to. No denominational name is going to give us salvation. No denomination is going to save us. This is the issue. So, as she said in Review and Herald, Volume 5, page 110, I said, as is Ellen White speaking while she was inspired, if any of the citizens of Battle Creek wish to know what Mrs. White believes and teaches, let them read her published books. My labors would be not should I preach another gospel. That which I have written is what the Lord has bidden me write. Look at this. She was writing this way because her books were being changed. And she was arguing back with the people, letting them know that you're wrong. You're committing a sin. I stand firm in the Adventist faith, for I have been warned in regard to the seducing sophistries that will seek for entrance among us as a people. Richard, the scriptures say, some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. I present before our people the danger of being led astray as were the angels in the heavenly courts. The straight line of truth presented to me when I was but a little girl is just as clearly presented to me now. In Testimonies, Volume 5, page 434, their testimonies, God has given us specific direction. Can I hear an amen? God has given us specific direction, and that specific direction is a blessing. Sketches of the Life of Paul, page 325. Sketches of the Life of Paul, page 325, reads, God has declared his will, and it is absolute madness for man to change or to question what has gone out of his lips. Wow. Absolute madness. Spiritual Gifts, Volume 3, page 14 to 15, Facts of Faith. This book is correct. It was not infiltrated. It is dangerous business in the service of God to deviate from his institutions, those who have to do with God, who is infinite, who explicitly directs in regard to his own worship, should follow the exact course of his course he has prescribed, and not feel at liberty to deviate in the smallest respect, because they think it will answer just as well. God will teach his creatures that he means just what he says. His word is not going to return back to him void. It's going to return back to him perfect through Christ. And what this denomination has done since its inception and its organization will pay dearly now and to the end. There is no mind that can deviate from the truth other than a man taking their eyes off Christ. Once we have our eyes on Christ and we go through these sacrifices or these sufferings, let me tell you, they're not going to be something mild. They're going to be tough. Okay? Now, compare Acts of the Apostles, page 508, is removed in this book. It's been omitted. So what I read to you from Spiritual Gifts, volume 3, page 14 and 15, it was omitted from Acts of the Apostles. Okay? So Acts of the Apostles, what I just read to you was omitted from this book. They took it out and rewrote it so that you have no idea of what's being said in the sanctuary. Okay? This is what happened. And Testimonies, Volume 5, their book, page 434, God has given us directions so that no one need err. Ah, what a blessing. Man shall not live by bread alone, he says, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. The truth given by inspiration is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. That is correct. Can I hear an amen? Now, as long as we continue to play church, because the church right now, all the denominations play Catholic Church. We're not at fault. Oh, yes, we are. Read the scriptures, Richard. Understand the writings that she's given to us. Read the testimonies to the church. If not, we're going to be found guilty. That's almost a direct quote from Mrs. White. But I want to share something. Not by one word, not by many words, but by every word that God has spoken shall man live. You cannot disregard one word, a single injunction that he has given, however thrilling it may seem to you, and be safe. Did you hear that? You cannot trifle with your salvation in these corrupt books. You must seek to get these correct books, that your character, that your behavior, that your cleansing, your repentance is final. Okay? And continuing, let me take a breather here. Whoever therefore shall break one of these least commandments and shall teach men so, he shall be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. Have you been directed that way? Because this is exactly what's happening. And I'm referring to the books. I'm referring to the books. It doesn't have to be so much in talk, but what's more profitable is your actions, your verbs, what you're doing. That is what's being done. You can talk all you want on that pulpit. Because it's judgment, judgment, judgment. Every time anybody talks, ordained or not, degree or not, when you talk, as I'm talking, it's judgment, judgment, judgment. And if it's not truth, nah, you're trifling with your soul. Okay? We all mean well. But for crying out loud, if you seem to be so educated and so grounded in your own faith, then why aren't you reading the original books? Why aren't you teaching me original books? When I go to your church, I listen to your sermons. They're good and stuff, but your quotations coming out of the Great Controversy 1911 is corrupt. Who's the problem now? Oh, you got a problem, Richard. You're making accusations. No, I'm not, because I'm showing you the correct book, and I'm showing you what you read out of the new book of a new order, but you don't want to change because you're hard in your heart. Oh, I got a degree. I went to school. You didn't. Oh, I went to school. I got 9 years of theology. That doesn't mean anything. It's a matter of consistency of studying and studying and studying. Christ is not going to give everything to me in 1 year. Mm-mm. He don't work that way. But he will now. He's going to work more for us now than he did in the past. Because everything that Daniel wrote, everything that John wrote in the book of Daniel, Revelation, or in the writings of the Bible, are for our learning, our admonition, that we may give to other people. Therefore, whosoever will willfully break one command cannot, in spirit and in truth, keep any of them. He may claim that, with the exception of what he may regard as slight deviations, he keeps them all. Yet if he willingly offends in one point, he is guilty of all. And I've done that. Can I hear an amen? We've done that. But we got to come to the time, which is now in 2016, that I'm done with playing with sin. I'm done accepting money and following what they want me to do. Because you see, the money is the principle of do, excitement. Oh man, now I can pay my rent. Oh, now I can get some gas. It's the money. It's not so much of a sacrifice. You see, that's the difference. Now, as I shared with you before, you got the little demon, you got the little evil demon inside that dollar bill. You all know it. You've seen it. You see when that money was put together in 1940 in the dollar bill, you see the little emblems and the little skull and the little owl in that dollar bill, who it all belongs to. And they admit, yeah, that belongs to us, Freemasons. Well, we're doing business with it. Huh? Who's lying to who? Who's teaching who? Everything's going to be revealed before Christ comes. That's why these books, the correct books, are being revealed, opposing corrupt books of a new order. Okay, now there's books throughout the whole place here, but I want to share with you, you got to get the books. It's about reading. That's the secret. It's about reading. So when you read, you want to know its history, when it was first given. And you want to read the present tense, and then you want to read the future. What does it deal with the future, or does it have anything to do with the future? And I should say, absolutely. I should say so. Can I hear an amen? Now, 2 Chronicles chapter 36. Turn with me to 2 Chronicles chapter 36. And in 2 Chronicles chapter 36, we come across verses 15 and 16. And the Lord God, and in the original Hebrew it should say, and the Yehovah Elohim of their father sent to them by his messengers, rising up bedtimes and sending because he had compassion on his people and on his dwelling place. But they mocked the messengers of God and despised his words and misused his prophets until the wrath of the Lord arose against his people till there was no remedy. And that's what's happening in today in 2016. Okay, now here's what it's saying. They've rejected the messengers. They've rejected Ellen G. White when she was alive. Now even now she's dead, they want to give her credit. They've already made a $30 billion deal off her books. All they do is put her name on it. Yep, she wrote it. But you have no idea if you're reading the original books. That's the issue. That's the argument I have. Now when we go to court, you better have this correct because you will be going to court. Not sometime in the future. You're going to court now. We're in the judgment scene. We're in the judgment scene. And what he's actually saying is, come out of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, which is a nominal Adventist church, and you join my remnant, Richard. It's a remnant that's going to go through with the correct message. Not with all this mistake, all this Babylonian confusion. That's what he's really saying. And you wouldn't know that because you haven't read the books. Like Donald Trump says, fair is fair. I'm saying fair is fair. So you can talk bad about me all you want, but you got the scriptures now. You got the scriptures. You know, years ago the Lord called me, but he called me out of a cell. And what's interesting about that was that it says, and your ears shall hear a word behind thee saying, when you turn to the right hand, to the left hand, walk ye in it. Well, I want to walk in the truth. Can I hear an amen? I'm turning to the right, to the left. I want to walk in the truth. I don't want to walk in all this confusion. I'm tired of that. The church hasn't gone any further than what it has since it was called many, many years ago. It hasn't done anything since 1994. There's no difference. The only difference is teachings have been crippling in. Books of a new order, etc. But my books of a new order that I'm referring to you are their books. These are the original books. And it's prophesied that we will return back to them and finish the work. And that's what's holding us all. We got to return to them and attain the books. Because eventually we're gonna end up giving it away anyway, because everything's going to fall. Okay? Now, excuse me. Spawning them again, page 481. And listen to me, and I'm going to be very personal here for everyone that's present and for those that are viewing. Spawning them again, page 481. Be not afraid of man, Richard. I'm inserting that. For my shield shall protect you, Richard. I'm inserting that. It is not you that speaketh, Richard. I'm inserting that. It is the Lord that giveth the messages of warning and reproof, Richard. Because he's talking to me. And I'm bringing it to your remembrance. Never, never deviate from the truth under any circumstances, ladies and gentlemen. Give the light I shall give you. The messages for these last days in 2016 shall be written in books and shall stand immortalized. What? It shall stand immortalized. That is powerful. To testify against those who have once rejoiced in the light, but who have been led to give it up because of the seductive influences of evil. Isn't that a shame? That's what happened. And that's what's going to continue to happen. Sanitarium, California, May 26, 1906. Alan White was alive. Your next reference is First Selected Messages, book page 32. Now, pay close attention to this one. She says, How many have read carefully Patriots and Prophets, The Great Controversy, The Desire of Ages? I wish all to understand that my confidence in the light that God has given stands firm because I know that the Holy Spirit's power magnified the truth and made it honorable, saying, this is the way, walk ye in it, in my books. Whose books? Her books. The truth is stated, barricaded by thus saith the Lord. Now, you notice that the names, Patriots and Prophets, The Great Controversy, Desire of Ages, are all in italics. That means that is not original. Now, who in the world wrote that and inserted Patriots and Prophets, Desire of Ages, and The Great Controversy? Who inserted it? Huh? Have you ever asked anybody who did that? The italics are on the names of the books above, which are four. Patriot, well, actually, two or three are on the names above the books, which means are not the original names of the books. Okay? This is the argument here. Then you're going to say, well, what should we read, Richard? Well, you need to get Spirit of Prophecy, Volumes 1, 2, 3, and 4. You want to know what's happening now, what's coming? It's all in there. But you're not going to know them here in these books because Harlan College representatives, Hail Mary with Keep the Faith Ministries, means well. Good speakers. You got all these, Thomas Jackson with Meet Ministries. You got Steps to Life out there in Kansas. You got all these self-supported ministries, big or small, whatever they are. People with PhDs and degrees, etc., kicking back at home, listening to everybody else, and only going to churches where other PhDs are present. Can I hear an amen? Come on, give me a break. You can't lie to a liar. Okay, your game's over with. Well, I'm stripping your characters. Who in the world have you thought you were teaching when yet there was something else coming that is going to be far greater and powerful? You see, Christ does all the ordination. Because the foolishness of man has been ordained to be recognized in the denomination as ordained and to wear the cloth of Elohim. That's fine. But guess what? Christ does the ordination. Okay? And so whatever you plan on doing, you better make sure that your road is a calling from heaven. Heaven above means heaven above. Okay? But it comes from the sanctuary. And you need to ask yourself, is this for me? Am I doing this? Is this from you? Or is this man's idea? Using psychology to keep you in the church and to have your money. Because you make good money because you got a good job. You got a good IQ. Now, the Holy Spirit traced these truths. This is what Alan White says. The Holy Spirit traced these truths upon my heart and mind as indeniably. Now, I'm going to elaborate on that word in a little bit. As the law was traced by the finger of God upon the tables of stone which are now in the ark, letter 90, 1906, also found in Culpeper Ministry, page 126. Now, the word indeniably is a very important name or word because you can't erase it. Did you hear me? Oh, I love that. Yes. I see the heads nodding. Now, indeniably means no one has the rights or privileges to change one jot or one tittle from the Spirit of Prophecy books. In these last days, the Spirit of Prophecy is to be revived in 2016 so we can go home. Mark Finley knows of the original books, but he's kept hush to protect his name and to get a good paycheck. Okay? Now listen to me. The original books are already being revived. This might be something new to you as a listener. You might be thinking I'm talking about the Seventh-day Adventist. Well, look, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist. So if I'm going to share dirt with you, and then you're going to share dirt with me, well, we got a relationship. We got a relationship. But if I'm going to give you truth, and you're not accepting it, now we don't got a relationship. It's plain and simple. So in the Bible where it says in John 3:16, for Yahweh sent his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should what? Be saved and have eternal life. Not perish. Thank you. Now we got a relationship. Thank you. Now we got a relationship. Right? But if the person didn't say that and said the opposite, we don't have a relationship. This is what's happened here. I'm giving you little analogies. It might be much, but I want to share with you that it does mean something. Okay, this is just an open view right now. This is just a big old introduction. I'm agitating your minds so that you can get the desire. Instead of go buying those brand new shoes, you put down $70 to get the Spirit of Prophecy books and use it for your edification, for your church growth, for your salvation, so that you can win other people into the sanctuary. It's just not the person that's ordained. It's everybody that's inside the church because they've been ordained already. So we're over here fighting about among each other about all this minute little stuff. We'll get it together. You might have the money to get a printing machine. Well, let's print the books. Donate that. Now, millionaires will come into the message, but they're going to come into the message if it's correct. I can give you a big story about Mr. Hugh Hunt, who sponsored the money for the books. He was a millionaire. But at the same time, I had to do my work correctly to the best of my ability. But at the same time, we must not take advantage of the people. He goes through the books. That's where we need to have an employment, etc. So let me continue on going here. I'm going to give you an outline of the correct original names of the Spirit of Prophecy volumes 1 through 4 books. And I want you to focus on the dates. Okay? Now, Spirit of Prophecy, the great conflict between Christ and his angels and Satan and his angels, was written in the year 1870. Pages and Prophets, when was that written? Do you remember the date I gave you? All you got to do is rewind the DVD so you can get that answer. This is why I'm asking you, write everything down. If you write it down, it's going to stay in here. Okay? You can remember. You can claim John 14, verse 26. Now, let me give you the second name of the second book, Spirit of Prophecy. The Spirit of Prophecy, the great controversy between Christ and Satan, Life, Teachings, and Miracles of Our Lord Jesus Christ, was printed in 1877. The Spirit of Prophecy, the great controversy between Christ and Satan and the death, resurrection, and ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ, was written in 1878. Now, there's a key I'm going to make here. The Spirit of Prophecy, the great controversy between Christ and Satan from the destruction of Jerusalem to the end of the controversy, was printed in 1884. Now, I'm repeating this. Okay. These you may look up and read. They are very important. These are the names of the books. Okay. Now, the Great Controversy, when it came out, I'll pull this one out. The Great Controversy, when it came out, it had on there the Great Controversy between Christ and his angels and Satan and his angels, but it had Satan in here with bat wings. And then it had a key. And in that key, at the end of the key, had a Catholic cross. And the book is green, by the way. It's the 1888 version. And on top, you got an insignia up here, like a little circle, which represents It represents the Eucharist. Thank you. Thank you very much. It represents the Eucharist. Now, what they did, they finished printing those books. Now, remember, green represents for occultism. The book was printed in green. It's a corrupt book, but it had all that in there. And here he had the Eucharist here at the back of it. Okay, that you, there's very, very maybe one out of a million might have this book left. Okay, but a lot of people have died off. I have it in another slide, but I wanted to bring this out to share it with you. These are just some of the things that have occurred. Now, I want to share with you that these books are very important, and if you don't have them, you can feel free to give us a call. We have them. We sell them, and the money is used to continue printing them, to continue to give them to ministries, to people. People really don't have the money, or we sell them. However, I wanted to share with us a warning. This is very important, so you understand what church you're in, what church you've been in, and what's been held back from you. Now, if we don't do our homework, then we're going to go with the flow. And your spirit is going to get weak. You're going to get lonely, whether you're married or not. And you're going to say, you know, well, I'm only following what they're telling me to do, etc. No, that's not how church works. And if you object, then you're not part of the group. Well, then what in the world do I do then? You study to make yourself approved, rightly dividing the word of truth. Now, the time is not far distant when the test will come to every soul. Rather you keep the commandments or you don't, the test is going to come to you. So nobody's left out. Fair is fair. I think Christ is fair. Can I hear an amen? Now, the mark of the beast represents Sunday worship, equals a moed in Hebrew. It's a moed. It means an appointed time. It's the Father that will say and release the issue to take place when you're going to worship by force. Okay? It's not Congress. It's the Father. This is His people. This is His church. This is His world. But He's given dominion to HaSatan, the devil, Satan. Okay? We can overcome him only through Christ. Okay? Now, the mark of the beast will be urged upon us. Those who have step by step yielded to worldly demands and conformed to worldly customs, even in the churches, listen to me, will not find it a hard matter to yield to the powers that be. So, if you're yielding to all this stuff that's going on in your denomination, no matter what it is, it doesn't work in the remnant. We don't play those games. Are you hearing me? He says, no. And so I say, no. So, if you're already compromising with what's going on in business meetings, you're going to do it when the test comes. Because if you're not mortifying this soul, this mind, then you're not going to be prepared when it happens. And it can happen without you even knowing because we've been asleep. Okay? This is what's happening right now. So when you're having a board meeting, guess what? You're not having a Bible board meeting. You're having a professionally world business board meeting because the world's come into it. So your experiences in your professionalism where you're speaking at or representing high or low, but it's professional, then you're bringing that experience on into the board. You're not bringing Christ's character. Yeah, you're having prayer, but you're not having a really Christ-centered board meeting of that person. You're using the scriptures and using the spirit of prophecy. Well, wait a minute. Using the new books of a new order, spirit of prophecy, and the scriptures to downfall that group or those people. And to make your decisions on the direction your group of the church in the city is going to go. Who's talking to who now? So when we see spirit of prophecy principles and the Bible being enacted correctly and drawn out correctly, now we're on a premise. Because it's not me that's speaking or the board members. It's the spirit of prophecy speaks only truth. The Bible speaks only truth. Okay? Therefore, those who have step by step yielded to worldly demands and conformed to worldly customs will not find it a hard matter to yield to the powers that be, rather than subject themselves to derision. Now, the powers that be. The elder of the church is going to do exactly what the conference representative is telling the elder of the church to do, through the pastor. Okay? Now, the issue here is, the Bible's correct. You're not correct, Peter. Well, this is what we're going to do. Why? Because there's another leader above him that's going to tell him what to do, as well as the other district leaders. Are you listening to me? So what's going on here? Huh? I don't got a voice because I'm not part of the board? Huh? I got a voice just as much as if you're in the board or not. You got a board. You got a voice. You paying your tithes and offerings? You got a voice. You can be in those board meetings, whether you've been asked or not, because you're not an elder or a female elder. You got the right to be in those board meetings. You can't speak, though. But guess what? You can speak to those who are in the board meeting after or before the session and give your views and opinion and give your paper to them to present the truth. Okay? This is how you work. It's the same thing with legislation. It's the same thing in politics. It's the same thing. The church works the same way as legislation, the same way as voting. There's no difference. So why don't we come out and be separate and come out of Babylon? Now things are going to work. And let me tell you, Christ doesn't need the money. He needs consecrated souls that can commit to the Holy Spirit and receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, being sealed with that promise to give this message. Now until the second coming. Will it get lonely? You better believe it'll get lonely. But guess what? All the apostles, all the prophets, Ellen White, they were all lonely people just like me too, and you as well. There's no exception. There's no exception. Now, here's the key point. Those who have step-by-step yielded to worldly demands and conformed to worldly customs will not find it a hard matter to yield to the powers that be in the year 2016. Rather than subject themselves to derision, insult, threatened imprisonment, and death, the contest is between the commandments of Yahweh and the commandments of man. That's what's before us. Now, too bad I didn't have this in the screen so you could see it, but when you get the DVDs, you can see it on your screen. Now, in reference to this letter, it comes from the original Battle Creek letter, 1882, page 63, which is correct. It reads thus, in this time, comma, the gold will be separated from the dross in the church. Now, in this time, comma, the gold represents the people, the honest, consecrated, justified, sanctified people in the church. Separated means you come out of the Seventh-day Adventist church, which is a nominal Adventist church, and the dross, which stays in the denomination of the Seventh-day Adventist church around the world, those are the wicked. You also find the manuscript in Maranatha, page 200. But it says, in this time, it says, in this time, there's no comma. Okay, there's other references in other books, but I'm going to just stay here with this one so I won't get you so confused. So when you get these DVDs, you'll be able to see these diagrams, okay? And this is what Ellen White told them. And it took place in 1882, previous to the 1883 General Conference session. She says, in this time, comma, the gold, the pure, the holy people, they come out and will be separated from the wickedness, the dross, in the Seventh-day Adventist church. That's what's happening now. That's what's been happening. In order to make a remnant, you got to come out. In order to give the three angels' message, you got to come out. In order to live a sanctified life, you got to come out. Why? Because we're connected with sinners within the church. It's not the church that's going to be saved. It's your souls, individual souls in corporate manner. Why? Because they join a remnant. They join Christ, who's giving the correct message. So when you read Christ Object Lessons, when you read Christ's Object Lessons, the last two chapters, you will read about the procession, where they come out of the Adventist church and they join the procession to give the message. By the way, when they come out, when the Adventists come out, they're already given the message. Can I hear an amen? They join the remnant, people, souls that are alive, literally. Okay? This is what's happening. Now, when you read in this time, it's talking about present tense. Continue. That's what it means, okay? Now, we're going to get a little bit into this vocabulary here, grammatically, in what it says, because it's very important that you see this and understand what's happened. Sure, the Seventh-day Adventist Church got some good messages and so forth, but they don't got the books. That's the problem. Sanctification is lacking. Faithfulness is lacking. Evangelists are lacking. Review and Herald has closed down. Once it closes down, the church ceases to exist. There's a few more little book companies that are still opening. Self-supporting ministries have a few printing little shops, but they're not printing the correct books. Okay, now stay with me here now. Now, the gold is referring to the people that come out of the organization of the church. Okay, because it says come out. It's referring to the people. Seventh-day Adventist church are the wicked individuals who are the dross in the church. They stay in the church. They go down deep into hell. The remnant says this is the way when you turn to the right hand or to the right hand. When you turn to the left hand or to the right hand. This is 144,000 people, Isaiah 30, verse 21. Now, for your reference, it's in Review and Herald, Volume 3, page 69. And this is what it says. The wicked stay in the Seventh-day Adventist church, and thou, Capernaum, and then in brackets, Seventh-day Adventists, who have had great light, listen with me, which are exalted unto heaven in point of privilege, shall be brought down to a hell, H-E-L-L. What does that mean to us? Wait a minute. Why are you saying this? This was way back when, 1893. We're going to be brought down to hell then, because it's already in it. For if the mighty works which have been done in thee, had been done in Sodom, now it's comparing Sodom and Gomorrah, it would have remained until this day. Review and Herald, Volume 3, page 69, August 1st, 1893. Correct. This is when the prophecy was given. When was it fulfilled? August 1st, 1893. But in the review, June 10, 1852, 8 years later from 1844, it went into the Laodicean state. Judgment hit August 1st, 1893. So what's happened? Are we trying to revive the church? This is why you're not allowed to read the correct books. But you're reading books of a new order to make everything look nice and dandy and pure. That, hey, we're going to go through, all right, hallelujah. Holy, holy, holy here and holy, holy over there. No, you got to see the clear picture of what's going on here. Because we're not making a new church here. There's no time to make a new church. It's only joining a remnant that's already existing. It's existed before you were born. However, they changed it in the following books of a new order. Testimonies to the Church, Volume 9, page 265. Testimonies to the Church, Volume 9, page 265. It's the 1948 edition. Now, I forgot to mention, all testimonies, Volumes 1 through 9, were all printed in 1948. When was it printed? 1948, all nine of them. It reads, "And thou, Capernaum, which art exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to hell." What's missing? What's missing? Seventh-day Adventists. They omitted the name Seventh-day Adventists out of it. Books of a New Order. Which books do you want? These books or those books? You want those books? Or these books? Thank you. Does that make sense? Does that make sense? Watch when we read them. Watch when we go through them. What's going to happen? Now, let me share this with you. Review. June 10th, 1852, they went into the Laodicean state and never come out of judgment. However, except those who are faithful come out, early writings, they cut out the information in the new books and join a procession referring to the remnant, Christ's Object Lessons. You may read the last two chapters. However, in closing, I want to share a very key point. In the year 1918, Stephen Haskell recalled a conversation with Mrs. White, some 40 years previous. According to Haskell, Mrs. White predicted there would be a time when the testimonies would be in demand. Are you listening, gentlemen? Just as they were originally given in order to meet objections. To meet what? Objections. Richard, these objections now are taking place. They're now taking place. Before we got through, reference, the 1919 Bible Conference, page 24 and 25. The spirit of prophecy is here seen among special signs of the last days. Its revival, that's the key word, its revival in the last days was to constitute one of the most noted signs of the approaching end. This is evident from it's being classed with the most prominent signs in the sun, in the moon, and in the stars, and such wonders in the heavens above and in the earth beneath, as blood and fire and vapor of smoke. Of all the blessings which God has bestowed upon his people, the gift of his son expected, can I hear an amen? None have been so sacred and so important to their welfare as the gift of the holy law and his Holy Spirit, and none have been so well calculated to thwart the plans of Satan and consequently to stir his rage as these. So, his son has been given, the gift of his holy law has been given, and the gift of the Holy Spirit has been given. Bear with me. And when that people should arise in the last generation of men, who shall be observing all 10 of the precepts of God's holy law, and should recognize the revival of the spirit of prophecy, which is now being recognized, they might expect to feel that bitterness from their opponents, which can arise only from the direct inspiration of Satan. Richard, and the dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of Yahweh and have the testimony of Yeshua HaMashiach. Revelation 12, verse 17. In Revelation 19, verse 10, it says, the testimony of Yeshua, said the angel to John, is the spirit of prophecy. Is the what? The spirit of prophecy. It is the keeping of the commandments of Yahweh and the recognition of the revival of the spirit of prophecy by the remnant of the church or the Christians of the last generation that stirs the ire of the dragon. Spirit of Prophecy, Volume 1, pages 10, 11, and 12. It's the remnant people who go through only. The revival is the original Spirit of Prophecy books, ladies and gentlemen. And what is so important with this is that you and I are living right in the middle of what the apostles and the prophets wanted to see. This is the issue. My appeal to you that if you want to be part of his remnant people, I'd like to ask if you'd like to stand so that you can give recognition and to give that oath to our Savior. So for those that would like to be part of this remnant church, I'd like to appeal to you. Let us stand and we'll close in prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, I want to ask for your blessings upon those who are standing. And I also ask for your mercy upon us all, for we are all guilty. But your books reveal the truth of what's happened. This is just a little small synopsis of what has occurred. But you have much, much more to reveal to us as a people. But we ask for the baptism of your love afresh upon us. And we ask for the forgiveness of our faults, our sins, that we may live it at one man with you. Bless us this afternoon with thy Holy Spirit. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach we pray. And God's people said, Amen.